coming back to superposition, suppose the two waves have different amplitudes. Write down y1 is equal to a1 sin omega t, y2 is equal to a2 kx pi, right? Kx minus omega t plus pi. Okay? Okay, I'll try to see y2. You can write it as a2 sine of this cos of pi. You need to open it up plus see, otherwise, you can't deal with this. Now when you do y1 plus y2, this will come out to be a1 plus a2 cos of phi plus a2 sin of phi . Any doubt here? Now, do you remember how to deal with this expression a sin theta plus b cos theta? Do you remember how to further make it compact? Right, you multiply and divide by root over a square plus b square. Similarly, over here, your a is this and your b is this. Getting it? So you are going to get it as root over a square plus b square sine of kx minus omega t plus theta, where this is cos and this is sine. So tan of theta is a2 sine of pi divided by a1 plus a2 cos of phi. We have done something like this last class. Okay, then what is this? Is this the new amplitude? How much is that? Find out. Substitute this as a and this as b. So resultant amplitude root over a1 square a2 square plus 2a1 a2 cos of phi. Good. So resultant amplitude square is equal to a1 square plus a2 square plus 2a1 a2 cos of phi. Can you write it in terms of intensity? Resultant amplitude square is I resultant. This is equal to I1
plus I2.
I2 plus
2 root I1.
2 root I1 I2 cos of phi. Okay? This is what will happen if their amplitudes, the waves' amplitudes, are different. Okay? Fine? Any doubt? Now, similar to the previous this thing, find out the maximum and minimum intensities. I1 and I2 are given to you. You can change the value of phi.
So what is the phase? The phase is the same.
What?
Like what if the phase is the same? And the amplitude?
Then phi is zero. Anyone? So what is the maximum possible intensity? When it will be maximum, cos of phi will be then?
1.
So I1 plus I2 plus 2 root I1 I2.
Root of I1 plus.
So this is root of I1
plus root I2.
So root I1 plus root I2 whole square is the maximum amplitude, minimum intensity will be happening when cos of phi is
minus,
minus 1. Okay, so root I1 minus root I2 d whole square. So maximum intensity divided by the minimum intensity. See, this is not in your school curriculum, okay? Not part of your school curriculum. But whatever you have done earlier was in school curriculum. This is there in JEE curriculum. Is root over I1 plus I2 divided by root over this whole square. Now, I can write it in terms of the amplitude also. So this can be written as A1 plus A2 divided by A1 minus A2 the whole square. Okay, so if amplitudes are equal, minimum intensity is zero. But if they are not equal, minimum is not zero. Any doubts? Got doubt? Okay, so there are actually no questions in your textbook from this topic, but we'll take up. Let's talk about from where and how this phase difference come. Because you can see everything depends on phi. What is the value of phi? Okay? We'll take up one simple scenario. There are many more scenarios that you'll be learning in wave optics in class 12th. Okay? Now consider that scenario. Please write down. Two waves start with zero phase difference. Two waves starts with zero phase difference. One wave travels more distance than the first wave. The second wave travels more distance than the first wave. Will there be a phase difference? Initially, this is a scenario. Okay, from here one wave goes like this, here the other wave goes. When they start, there is no phase difference. But is there a guarantee that when they meet, there will not be any phase difference? There is no such guarantee. See, it is like this. If this is a wave and you start like this, if suppose this point meets with that point, they are not in the same phase. Because this wave has traveled more distance. Getting it? So just because this wave has traveled an extra distance, there will be a phase difference automatically generated. The reason is just because one wave has traveled an extra distance. Okay? So initially their phase difference is zero. So I need to find out how to get the value of the phase difference. Okay, so let's try to see that. Now, can you tell me that if I talk about one wavelength, let's say this is lambda. For one wavelength lambda, what is the phase change? 2 pi, right? So for lambda, 2 pi is the phase. After every lambda, you add 2 pi in the phase, yes or no? That is the way we have defined, or we have found out the wavelength lambda, okay? For lambda distance, 2 pi is the phase. So for distance of x1, the phase will be 2 pi by lambda times x1, yes or no? Phase per unit lambda divided by phase per unit distance multiplied by the distance, okay? Any doubts? So let's say this travels a distance of x1. So between z, let's suppose this is zero phase. This is zero phase. So at this point, this will be the phase of the first wave. Let's say this distance is x2. So this is phi1. So for x2, the phase difference will be 2 pi by lambda times x2. This is phi2. So difference, the phase difference between this wave and that wave will be how much? 2 pi by lambda x2 minus x1. this is the phase difference? Yes or no? Right? So if this phase difference is an even multiple of pi, what will happen? Constructive difference. So if this happens, intensity at this location will be 4I0. How to find that location? The location will be such that x2 minus x1 will be n times wavelength. The difference in the path traveled, if it is equal to the integer times the wavelength, there will be a constructive interference happening there. Okay? Now if the phase difference 2 pi by lambda x2 minus x1, this is equal to 2n minus 1 times pi by 2, destructive interference, or x2 minus x1 is, let us say, an odd multiple of lambda by 2, it will be a destructive interference. Okay? So, I don't want to stretch it more because already we are beyond your curriculum, but I have to tell this because just telling theory is not sufficient. So, how to visualize the phase is also important. Any doubts? Quickly tell me. No doubts. Where are you?
Sir, it should be lambda by 4.
What?
Should be lambda by 4.
Sorry, it is odd multiple of pi for destructive. Isn't it? That's what we have direct.
Sir, I have a general doubt in constructive interference. In chemistry, we had that when the waves go like this, it's constructive, but they're going opposite sides. So if at the end point.
In chemistry, you're talking about the Schrodinger's wave equation.
Yes, sir.
What is the molecular
orbit theory? Same thing. Sir. You're treating electron as a wave, particle wave.
So it was saying when they're going opposite sides also, it goes constructive and then it goes that way. Like if they're going this and then they go constructive, it goes up. So why does
they go constructive goes up means what?
So like it both the
probability of finding electron becomes higher if two waves constructively meet. Okay, so the amplitude increases. Amplitude means the density of electron there will be higher when they constructively meet. When they meet destructively, electron vanishes because electron is a wave there. So,
but they're going in opposite direction.
So what? It doesn't matter. You're talking about kx minus omega t meeting kx plus omega t, right? See, if you take your wherever they are meeting as x equal to 0. Put your origin there. So kx, your x is fixed, right? So k into x is just another constant. It adds to the phase, phi. Okay, one is phi plus omega t, other is phi minus omega t. Okay? And then if they are like that, then they will be totally out of, no, they're not totally out of phase. One is not, see what you are trying to assess. So you are saying that y is equal to a sine kx naught plus omega t and y is equal to a sine kx naught minus omega t. How can they constructively interfere? That is what you are trying to say. They will constructively interfere if the phase difference between them is this. 2n pi. Okay, now how this happens, how this phase difference comes out to be 2n pi if they are meeting like that, that is a different debate. But this has to be there. Okay, now the electrons meet in a different way, the way two electron waves, they meet, sometimes they create s orbital, sometimes they create sp hybridized orbital, sp2, sp3. Depending on how the waves are, where how the electron waves are meeting. And usually what happens is that standing wave gets generated. Then only the these orbitals sp2 sp3 sp3d2 and all that, they are actually standing waves. So one wave has to come from this side, other has to come in the opposite direction, because two waves, when they come in the opposite direction, then only standing wave get generated. Okay, so standing wave we haven't yet done yet. We have only talked about the waves when they are moving in the same direction. So if they are moving in the same direction, they will create a traveling wave, not a standing wave. Okay, so let's talk about standing wave, then it will be better. Fine, so please write down reflection. Reflection is a very, very common phenomena in the waves. Okay, so once there was a dog who was barking near the fence, and it was a constructed this thing wall. So every time dog used to bark, his sound used to get reflected, and he hears his own sound. He thought that there's another dog that side. So continuously for 3-4 hours he'll bark. Okay, so you know it can fool you at times. So don't get fooled. So we're talking about reflection of the wave. So when we talk about reflection of wave, the way the reflection happens in transverse is different from the way it happens in the longitudinal. Okay, not only that, the kind of reflection, whether it is hard reflection or soft reflection, even that has a bearing of what will happen after reflection. Okay, so let's take it one by one. We're talking about reflection on a transverse wave. First is the hard reflection. Basically, hard reflection, I'll tell you how it is defined. So when a wave is traveling from mu1 to mu2 and mu1 is less than mu2, okay? So what happens is, let's say this is a string. It is tied with a heavier mass density string. So a wave gets generated from here. It touches this end, so part of it will get reflected, part of it will get transmitted. So I am talking about this reflected one. Okay, so this reflected one is getting reflected from mu2. Earlier the wave was in mu1. Mu2 is more than mu1. So the thing is that wave is getting reflected from a denser medium, very crude way you can say that. So when the reflection happens from a denser medium, it is called hard reflection. Got it? Okay. In your textbook, a very simple example is given in which a string is tied to a wall, let us say, and there is a disturbance that is sent from here. The smallest unit of disturbance is called pulse. Okay? Pulse. So whatever happens to this pulse, it will happen to the entire wave, because it's the pulse will be attached to create an entire wave. So building block of wave is pulse. So this wave is traveling like this. So now this point is fixed on the wall. So after some time, this pulse will reach the end. Now reflection will happen. Okay, so what this point one is trying to do, tell me next, if suppose wall was not there, so this point one will try to do what? Talking about point one is in the medium. It'll try to move up. Transverse wave, right? Particles move up and down. So if this disturbance have to move forward, then the point should move up, right? But what you're doing, you're not letting it move up. It is applying a force on the wall in upward direction. Wall doesn't move because it has infinite inertia. But what wall will do? Equal and opposite force on the string. String doesn't have infinite inertia. So by the moment wall applies a force in opposite direction, an inverted pulse gets generated like this, and it will travel backwards. Got it? Everybody understood? Okay. So if incoming wave equation is this, incident wave equation is, let us say, A sine kx minus omega t, what will be the equation of the reflected wave? Assuming there is no energy loss in the reflection. Otherwise, if energy loss happens, amplitude will change. Amplitude is same. So what will be the reflected wave equation? That's all. A sine kx plus omega t, you said. So what is the difference between it getting inverted or like this only it travels back?
The y coordinate is
minus kx.
There will be an additional phase of pi. Yes or no? See, it is, this point is suddenly replaced by that point. The see, 1, 2, 3. After reflection, 2 suddenly coincided with 1. As if the wave got shifted this way. So a phase of pi has increased. Okay, so because of reflection, a phase of pi will get introduced in the hard reflection. Any other doubt?
So why did the minus become plus in omega d?
It is traveling in opposite direction. Negative x direction. Positive x I am taking like that. So this is the hard reflection. Let's talk about soft reflection of transverse wave. Soft reflection, the same scenario, mu 1 is more than mu 2 now. The wave was there in the denser rope and it is getting reflected from the rarer medium. Okay? So basically reflection from the rarer medium. Alright? So in your textbook, a simple example is given. There's a ring attached to one end of the string and it is passing through a pole like that. This ring is massless. Okay? Now, rod. So this pulse is traveling. Now, what will happen if this pulse reaches here? Anyone? It will pull the ring up. Ring will go up or not? Ring will go up. Okay? So ring goes up. With the pulse, it goes up. And then it will come down also. So it goes down. The rope has a little bit of inertia. So it will not stop there. It will go down. Okay? So as if somebody has taken this end and then like that. Up and down like that. Okay? So because of that up and down movement itself, there will be a reflection coming out like that. But now it will not be inverted. It will be exactly this way only. But just that velocity is changed. Okay, so if incident wave is A sine kx minus omega t, the reflected will be A sine kx plus omega t. Okay. Fine. So these are the two scenarios of the reflection for the transverse wave. Please write down longitudinal wave. We have 1 minute, we can finish that. Or we can do the reflection. Let's not finish quick. Fine, so this is what we have done today. Next class, we are going to do the reflection of the longitudinal wave, and then we are going to talk about the standing waves. After that, we are going to talk about the Doppler's effect. Next entire class will be on this chapter only. After that, we'll be doing some problem practice, okay? And then your syllabus is over, okay? Once your syllabus gets over, we can do some problem practice on some specific chapters. We can revise, in fact. We have 6 classes to revise entire class 11th. Okay? Or we can do optics. We'll discuss after finishing this course.